Ivan the Terrible, Wilfred the Hairy, Charles the Bold, Sigobert the Lame. Throughout history, many leaders have gained some rather questionable nicknames, but few were fortunate enough to have a nickname quite as welcome or a wealth quite as vast as Alexander the Great, whose fortune is estimated to surpass even that of Jeff Bezos. And let's face it, Alexander the Great is a much better nickname than Jeff the Billionaire. Today, we're going to take a look at how Alexander the Great earned and spent his massive fortune. You might be surprised that he spent his money pretty similar to a lot of modern-day billionaires, including blowing it on some pretty wild parties. Although his parties certainly involved a lot more murder than most modern-day gatherings. Well, at least the ones that I attend. Alexander the Great was rumored to be the son of Greek god Zeus himself. Just don't mention that to his biological dad, King Philip II of Macedonia. And though Alexander is the one who snagged the nickname, King Philip was pretty great himself. Using his political prowess and significant military knowledge, King Philip was able to help Macedonia become a powerhouse on the global scale, which is pretty impressive because for quite some time, Macedonia was the kind of empire you didn't want to stop and water your horse in, and certainly not one you'd send a scroll home about. His goal was not only to expand Macedonia, but to conquer the Persian Empire, which seemed about as realistic as Jar Jar Binks leading a Gungan army to take down the empire. Unfortunately, King Philip was assassinated in 336 BC, leaving Alexander to carry on his legacy. But fortunately, Macedonia was in good hands, because even as a young boy, Alexander was pretty extraordinary. Alexander's mentor was none other than Aristotle, the famed philosopher. At the age of 12, Alexander managed to tame a wild horse that grown men feared. The horse, Bucephalus, followed him throughout his entire military career and even had cities named in its honor. After his father's death, Alexander wasn't considered the direct heir to the throne, so he rallied an army and had all his rivals for the throne killed. Though he is considered to be great, Alexander sure had blood on his hands, and killing rivals for the throne was just the beginning. Alexander quickly got to work fulfilling his father's dream of expanding the kingdom and conquering Persia, and fortunately, he had a pretty successful and experienced army behind him. He first secured the Greek peninsula, taking over the city-states in the region through force. It wasn't until he waged the siege of Thebes, burning a city to the ground and selling the survivors into slavery, that many of the city-states agreed to join without a fight. Then, he trained his eye on Persia, which was then ruled by Darius III. In their first battle, Darius and his troops retreated so quickly that they left his wife, children and mother behind. That should paint a picture of how fearsome Alexander's army truly was. From there, he pressed further southeast into Asia, conquering cities as he went. Eventually, in another confrontation, he struck down Darius and eventually was able to claim the throne to become the King of Persia. Many battles followed this, but over his 15 years of conquest, he never lost a single battle. By the end of his life, Alexander was in control of a kingdom stretching from Greece down into Egypt and then all the way to India. And during his rule, he was perhaps the most wealthy man on the planet. But how exactly did he earn his fortune, which is estimated by many to be well into the billions? There are quite a few different ways, but the first, like many wealthy individuals, lies with his inheritance. King Philip had a vast royal treasure that was handed down to his son. In addition, Macedonia itself had a reliable source of income found within its mines, which produced gold and silver to be used for minting coins. As Alexander conquered Persia, he looted cities along the way. When the palaces within Babylon, Susa, Persepolis, and Ecbatana were ransacked, Alexander's haul was between 180,000 and 200,000 talents. That's without including the artwork, paintings, treasures, and other tangible valuables that were within the palaces, which certainly were worth millions. When he became king, After defeating Darius, he received the Persian royal family's treasure, full of jewelry, art, and of course, gold. From the Persian capital of Persepolis alone, it's estimated that he and his troops looted 2,500 tons of gold, which would be worth around $160.7 billion today. And that's just one city out of dozens that he conquered. In Gaza, he was recorded to have taken control of a storehouse of perfumes, which was immensely valuable. And aside from the looting, there was, sadly, something else of value in the cities that Alexander the Great took over, the citizens within them. Depending on how the battle with a particular city went, Alexander would sometimes burn cities to the ground and sell their people to slavery. On record, there are at least 24 instances of this occurring. There are very few details about how much Alexander actually made from selling the slaves, but considering the fact that he was known to sell up to 30,000 slaves at a time, it's safe to say he made quite a bit of money. Then, of course, there's the more boring way that Alexander made his money, taxes. But Alexander was one to pick and choose who paid taxes. Cities that didn't fight back were made to pay a certain amount of money, but yearly taxes were imposed on cities that were hostile or combative when Alexander tried to conquer them. The city of Ephesus, for example, held its own for quite a bit and were very, very resistant to being ruled by Alexander. Once he had taken control of the city, taxes were put in place, and the women of the city weren't permitted to wear jewelry. By the end of the war, it's estimated that his profits amounted to a startling 17 million pounds of silver. This was in a time period where a well-paid carpenter was earning just 0.3 ounces of silver per day. That carpenter would have to work for approximately 2.4 million years with no weekends off to earn as much as Alexander did during his 15-year conquest. So, yes, Alexander was pretty great when it came to money. But what exactly did he spend it all on? Well, we'll start with the fun stuff first. Alexander liked to party, like many modern billionaires. At the time of his death, he was only 32, meaning during the majority of his conquest, he was in his 20s, which is prime time to get lit, as the kids say. Although often these parties were a little bit too lit. Alexander threw a wine-drinking party in India, unaware that Indians weren't used to consuming alcohol as regularly as Macedonians. The prize for winning the contest was a talent of gold. The contestants wanted to win so badly that they drank themselves to death, resulting in 41 people dying of alcohol poisoning. Kind of a mood killer, if you ask me. Talk about not being able to handle your wine. But that wasn't the only party that Alexander threw. He was known for throwing many lavish parties, especially after claiming victory. Once a city was conquered, Alexander would often host games in honor of himself, providing an excess of food, drinks, and offerings to the gods. These parties would sometimes last for days, and in some cases, ended in the burning of a city that had been taken over. I've been to some wild parties in my day, but I guess there ain't no party like an ancient Greek party. During these parties, Alexander was often known to give gifts to friends or individuals who performed well in battle. This angered many of his followers, who grew frustrated with what they considered to be reckless spending. Good thing that many of those people were unaware that Alexander was spending an incalculable amount actively building temples and creating as many as 13 cities across his empire. Well, they would have probably been a little bit more than mad. Then, of course, quite a bit of Alexander's money went to supporting his troops, which were the most technologically advanced in the world at the time. Some of the costs were reasonable, like feeding the troops, building beds and accommodations, and even providing great medical care, which wasn't common at the time. Those who died of illness or in battle didn't have to worry about their family, because both their orphaned children and their parents would receive their salary. Often, soldiers' wives and children were transported as the troops moved, which required a completely separate transportation unit. Then, there were the less necessary costs of war. Alexander viewed himself as a god, and that was fairly evident when when you take a look at his accommodations. Alexander had special royal meals made just for himself and the closest guests, and it's estimated that he spent 600 talents per year on them, which is equal to thousands of pounds of gold. He had mattress guards every night, which guarded him and his other generals while he was sleeping. In the end, however, no mattress guards or regular guards could stop Alexander's death, which is believed by many to have been the result of him being poisoned at one of his extravagant feasts. So, there you have it, the life and immense wealth of Alexander the Great. What historical figure's wealth would you like me to dive into next? I quite love doing this research. Let me know in the comments down below. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to leave a like and subscribe, and maybe turn on post notifications. Thanks for watching. As always, I'm Mr. Luxury. Pip pip, da doodly doo.